Pattabi, Marco, welcome. Pattabi, to you first. Tell me about the opportunities and challenges when it comes to renewable project development.
Georgie, the renewable project development challenges are about the same worldwide. Generally speaking, it is getting access to land and sites. Second one being interconnection, being able to actually connect to transmission lines. And then everything around the supply chain has been upside down these days. To that, I would probably now add financing as well, because interest rates are up, and so project costs have gone up overall as a result of it. So all of those are the big challenges today on renewable development.
Marco, what is Aqua Power's vision for the future of the energy sector, and what are you doing to play your part in that future?
We're very excited about everything that is going on. I always say that renewables today are not developed out of ideology. They're developed because it's the cheapest, fastest, most secure energy form. And so everybody wants to build a lot of that, and we are right there. We're an enabler. For every dollar that we invest, we mobilize $10 of equity and financial partners. So we really believe that we bring together technology partners and everything, all the ecosystem that is needed to develop these renewables. So that's what we're doing for the environment today. We're doing more on green hydrogen and water desalination, because those can also be integrated with renewable energy in order to achieve a greater decarbonization of the energy sector.
What are you doing with those? Tell me a bit more.
So in green hydrogen or green ammonia, we are the first mover, I think, together with our partners, Air Products and NEOM in Saudi Arabia. We're developing an $8.5 billion project where we already invested more than $1.5 billion. It's going to come to production by the end of 2026. It's the largest in the world, fully dedicated for export. To give you an idea, 600 tons per day of capacity, the largest green hydrogen project in the United States, three. So it's 200 times bigger. We just broke ground on the second project in Uzbekistan to decarbonize the fertilizer sector for export into Europe, which is very relevant now with CBAM coming up. You need to decarbonize the system if you want to continue to import into Europe. On water desalination, we just launched at Red Sea Global, where we are providing the utilities to the Red Sea Global company, basically the big tourist destination, all the utilities. In water desalination, there is 100% fueled by renewables. In other projects in Saudi Arabia and the Emirates, 30% of the capacity of the energy demand is renewable energy.
Pattabi, so much innovation happening in this space. What is exciting you the most?
Well, what excites me the most is the scale of the projects that are going on. You know, I come from Texas, and we say everything is big in Texas.
Yeah.
Everything is bigger in the Middle East, it looks like. So the sheer scale of what we're looking at, and then the level of innovation that's happening from a technology standpoint, all exciting.
Not to put a dampener, though, on things, but what are some of the challenges that you're facing at the moment, Marco? And I suppose, what are some of the challenges you're foreseeing in the future?
So it's a different country from country. I would say here in the Gulf, the returns tend to be quite low. So you have to be extremely efficient on your supply chain. And that is because the scale we have here in the region is massive, and there's a lot of competition to reach and achieve basically a position in this market. For other markets, in emerging markets, I'm thinking now about Africa, Southeast Asia, the problem there is scale. So it's very difficult to achieve really the scale that we have in Saudi Arabia or the Emirates or Central Asia now for us. And so what we're trying to do is to work with the local governments on trying to see how we can accelerate the pace of development.
Finally, and overall, what are you hoping that will come out of this COP with regards to this sector and what it addresses, I suppose?
Yeah, let me start off. I'd love to hear Marco's perspectives as well. Energy Day is coming up on Tuesday, but there's a lot of obviously discussions and negotiations that have been happening over the course of the last 6 to 9 months. The big things remain the big things. So tripling renewables, doubling energy efficiency, near zero methane in the oil and gas value chain, and then scope 1 and 2 net zero by the oil and gas players across their full value chain. And then there's some new and exciting things, hopefully, that come out around getting clarity on hydrogen trade and having, you know, ability to be able to move hydrogen derivatives around the world in a consistent way. So those are some of the big things that are needed. And of course, hard to abate sectors and their role in how they reformulate their energy value chains. So those are my hopes and expectations. I'd love to hear yours, Marco.
I think I concur on the role of green hydrogen in hard to abate sector. As I mentioned, you know, there's no no debate today on renewable energy for power generation. That's happening. I think where we need to focus is the hard to abate, where you need a green hydrogen or green ammonia as a solution on a global trade. That is something that is emerging. So we need to work together both on the regulation, the definition, and try to find the scheme that is best to basically achieve export projects from the most competitive market here in this area, from North Africa, Middle East, but also Southeast Asia, into the final demand that is mainly we see Europe, Japan, Korea.
Marco, Pattabi, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.